My dear brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So we will continue inshallah where we got to the point where Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah ta'ala started listing many verses from the Quran in regards to asma and sifat, the names of Allah and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why Shaykh al-Islam started listing some of these verses? Because if you look at the Aqeedah Wasatiyyah that the Shaykh al-Islam wrote, one of the main objectives of this Aqeedah is that he differentiate Ahl al-Sunnah and Jama'ah from the deviated groups in the issue of Asma and Sifat, the names of Allah and the attributes. Because many groups like Mu'tazila, the people who put their minds and their thinking ahead of the verses of the Quran and the Sunnah, and they made their own understanding or aql, or their understanding, the judge on the verses of the Quran and the Sunnah, and they also negated and invalidated the names of Allah and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we gave examples many times that they say Allah is Sami', but he is not Sami' in the same time. So they come with the name or the word, and they come with the negative of it, as it doesn't exist. And we Ahl al-Sunnah, as we said before, we affirm what Allah affirms for himself, and we negate what Allah negates for himself. It's very simple. And if you read the Quran, you will find Allah, many, many verses. Allah says He's Sami' Basir, He's Alim, He's Qadir, and so forth. So we have to accept these names and these attributes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called Himself with. We cannot change it. So today we'll go through some of these verses that the Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah also used to support his argument that this is the Aqeedah of Ahl al-Sunnah, that we believe in Allah the way the Prophet ﷺ used to believe, and the way the understanding of the first generation of Islam understood Islam, and understood even the Tawheed itself, which is the fundamentals of Islam. So the verse we got to now is وَقَوْلِهِ. I mean, we say قَوْلِهِ is what the Shaykh al-Islam quoted. قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah is the provider, and he has the ultimate power. You know, and that's what the verse means. Actually, this is a verse that if you read recite the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ رِزْقًا وَمَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ أَن يُطْعِمُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah has created mankind and jinn to worship Him alone. This is the main purpose of creation. And Allah does not need us to provide Him with anything. Allah doesn't need us. We need Him. We are Allah is Ghani. What Ghani means, we said, Ghani is the one who does not need others. The others need Him. When you need somebody, you are faqir to Him. You are the faqir. That's why, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ أَنْتُمُ الْفُقَرَاءُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. We go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we ask Him for His rizq, to give us something. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the raziq. And He has the rizq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in the Quran, and we said in the beginning, Tawheed has three main components. Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, Tawheed al-Asma'u al-Sifat. Now Rububiyyah stands in main four things. Al-Razq, Allah is the raziq, Allah is the khaliq, Allah is the mudabbir. And what else? Also, the amr is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These four things Allah is controlling. So the rizq of mankind is in His hands. That's the attribute of the Rabb, of the God. He is the razq. Everything is in His hand. وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. In the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to what? To seek for His rizq. Don't stay. I mean, if we stay here in the masjid all the time, nobody will pay us anything. You have to go and work and فامشوا في مناكبها ها وسعوا في مناكبها وكلوا من رزقه. You have to go and strive and work and find a job and rizq will come. You have to work to get the rizq. Rizq is not going to come and while you are sitting at home or in the masjid. You have to go for it. You have to strive for it. So, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Now, the Shaykh mentioned الرزاق as what? As a name. Why is bringing this verse? Because he's telling the deviated groups, Allah is the one who is giving rizq. We call him الرزاق is his name. His attribute, he gives rizq. He's the provider. This is his attribute. Now, the second portion of the verse, ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. He has the power. Also now we have attribute of quwwah, of power. We mentioned earlier that Allah is bigger than anything we can imagine. Okay, it's Allahu Akbar, it's Allah is big. Al-Mateen is another name. What Mateen means has the more power. Yeah, that's what it means. Shadeed al-quwwah. So Allah affirming in this verse, He is the most powerful. In the human beings, you know, we are weak. We think sometimes we are strong. Now, the analogy we always bring into this to the discussion is that we have some power, right? I can talk, I can shout, I have some power, I can carry things, I have some power. But is it the same power as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power? No. That is what differentiates us from other people. Now, if somebody tells you are mushabbiha, you're calling yourself mateen, or strong, and Allah is the strong. So, Allah is strong is true. And we have maybe some strength. But the strength of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much bigger than ours. We cannot compare things together. We mentioned this, there is no tashbih, la tashbih. We are not similar. We don't say also how. Because we just affirm the meaning. And we do not compare or make similar. But we accept what Allah is calling Himself. He's powerful. And so forth. So this is, yani, I think, from this small verse, we learn several things. Allah is al-Raziq, His name. He is the Mateen, is another name. And He have three attributes that He mentioned. So we accept Him as is. Now, if somebody denies these things from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's changing the meaning. He's changing what the Prophet and his companions believed in. So we cannot change these things. We have to accept them as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. Yani if somebody tells you, no, it's quwwah, it means just support. No, it's quwwah, it's real power. Otherwise, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that? He described Himself with it. It's not for us to change that meaning. Okay? طيب. Then the Imam rahimahullah says the other verse, which we talked about several times actually, because it's the fundamental of the concept of or the tawheed of asma and sifat. ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. Nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is the ever hearer and ever seeing and so forth. So سميع and بصير, سميع in the Quran comes in two meanings actually. The one who hears and the one who actually responds to the action. Like what Allah says in the Quran, Inna Allah, the verse of Inna Allah la sami'u du'a. Sami'u du'a means the one who responds to your du'a. Okay, of course he hears you, then he responds. So we have the two meanings are in one verse. قد سمع الله قول التي تجادلك في زوجها. Allah will hear that woman who complained about her husband. So we believe Ahlul Sunnah, Allah hears everybody. ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. ليس this we cannot say equal or similar or مشابه. These are absolutely not acceptable. Allah سبحانه وتعالى, nothing is like Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We cannot even say how. Okay. Now, because we talked about this several times, يعني same thing البصير. It could be have يعني إن الله بصير بما تعملون. بصير بما he's knowing what you're doing. بصير here is not just seeing, it's also beyond seeing. He knows also. It has the two meanings in it. Okay, now the third verse that he has, actually he has not third, but we mentioned maybe 10 last time, and now we're gonna maybe mention another 10 verses. إن الله نعم يعظكم به إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. This verse actually starts إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل إن الله نعم يعظكم به إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. This verse has a story. What the verse means, Allah سبحانه وتعالى is commanding you to render the trust and be honest and be just and pay back the trust that somebody trusts you with. Money, what is it? Whatever it, that trust is. And this is giving, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving you maw'idha, means commanding you gently or things like that. Advising you to follow, to accept, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing you and hearing you if you do this. Now, this verse has a story actually. And this verse actually revealed to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم when he opened Mecca. The story is, subhanAllah, يعني, after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم opened Mecca, he went to Kaaba. Okay, we know what, you know what Sadana means and Siqaya in Haram? Sadana and Siqaya is some of the sons of Ismail alayhi salam, they hold the keys of Kaaba and they have the privilege to serve the Hajjaj, the people who go, the pilgrimage who go to Hajj. They have the, and they were doing it as donation, يعني, as being generous. The Hajjaj or the Arabs come to Mecca to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and these people will host them. And it's a privilege that Allah is giving to the sons of Ismail. And then they reached a family called Ibn Abi Shayba. This family is still around actually, and they still hold the keys of Kaaba. Now, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam opened Mecca, he went and asked for the one of the Sahabas. His name Uthman ibn Talha. He's from that family. He asked him to give him the keys, or the key of the Kaaba. Then Al-Abbas, in one narration, and another narration, Ali said, they were lucky, they were like kind of anxious that the Prophet is taking the key, now it becomes to Bani Hashim. As if this now we can take the key, and we take that privilege to become the one who serves the Hajjaj and everything. It's an honor for them. Then Uthman pulled his hand back. Kind of, I don't want to, يعني, this is something generation after generation have been doing this. Now you're taking it from us. يعني, it was kind of not something, يعني, acceptable for him. It was very difficult. In the end, the Rasulullah told him, give me the key. And he gave the key to the Rasulullah. And he opened it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and inside, went inside the Kaaba. And there was an idol for Ibrahim alayhi salam. He said, ask him to remove it, and so forth. And he came back, actually, another narration. SubhanAllah, when you read this tafsir of this ayah, that the ayah was revealed inside the Kaaba. And the Prophet started reciting the ayah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعَظُكُمْ بِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. He was reciting the ayah and he called Uthman, here is your key. Here is your key. And now nobody, and he said to him, this is for you to save the, for the, nobody can, if anybody asks you and take it from you, he's a zalim. And nobody even, till this day, nobody even touched these family and taken the key from them, till this moment. And actually another narration, which is strange, that Aisha requested to go inside the Kaaba. And Rasulullah asked for Uthman, can you open the Kaaba for Aisha to go inside? He said, oh Prophet of Allah, it's late after Maghrib, we didn't open the Kaaba. He said, khalas, maybe tomorrow. And it's closed subject. Now, the fourth verse we have, ولولا إذ دخلت جنتك قلت ما شاء الله لا قوة إلا بالله. Now, but the first two, I mean, the previous two verses has two things, سميع بصير, the same names and the same attributes. So we're not adding more new ones. Now this one, ولولا إذ دخلت جنتك قلت ما شاء الله لا قوة إلا بالله. قلت ما شاء الله. Now, this is a question that we need to stand in it and learn something from the Sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ said in the Hadith, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله إيش؟ كنز من كنوز الجنة. Why? It's a treasure from the treasures of the heavens. This word, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله, كنز من كنوز الجنة. Why? Because actually we have no power, no energy, unless Allah give us that energy. We can be paralyzed in 1 second. And without His help, without the power He gives us, nothing will happen. Allah has given us so many things too. Our brains, our eyes, our everything we do, by Allah's power. Allah's power commanded this to happen. Allowed it. And that's why the power that we have is basically allowed by Allah's power. It's not because we have muscles and or we are very smart. No. That's why we say MashaAllah, La quwwata illa billah, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Yani the meaning in the Arabic is very strong actually. We have no power whatsoever unless Allah gives us this. That's why it's a treasure. When all your things that you all do, you go from the morning till the evening and do this, you go travel, you drive, you learn, you work, you do all this. Allah, without the help and the power Allah has given you, you would not have done anything. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowance. That's why the word is very strong. When you see something good, you say, MashaAllah. And we know this, the story of chapter Al-Kahf. The two guys, the two men who has gardens. And he told them to say, يعني, MashaAllah. La quwwata illa billah. Otherwise, your things will be haba'an manthur, nothing. Your garden will go in vain, will be demolished, or whatever. So, what we learn from this verse, that nothing, Allah's mashi'a, Allah's power is there. It's attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we, Allah give us some power that we can use. Okay. And it's not comparable, again. The power we have is not like the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though both of us has some power. I mean, but the ultimate power is Allah's power. Again, if it uses the verse of Bani Israel, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْبَيْنَاتِ وَلَكِنِ اخْتَلَفُوا فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ آمَنُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَفَرُ وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلُوا وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَفْعَلُ مَا يَشَاءُ. Now, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلُوا. وَلَوْ شَاءَ هنا means we say مَشِئَة. مَشِئَة. In other, we come also with the next verse also talks about what we call irada. Nothing happened. Remember when we talked about al-qadr? We said al-qadr has four pillars. Do you remember these things? مشيئة, the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing happened without His will, without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowing that. If we understand this, that means without His power, without His will, nothing will happen. And the mashayikh or the ulama say the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has two kinds. They say irada kawniya or mashi'a kawniya. If you remember, we said سيقول الذين أشركوا لو شاء الله ما أشركنا. The non-believers would say, if Allah allowed or willed, we could have been believers, but Allah did not allow. So, but Allah subhanahu gave them the choice. They have the chance, they didn't take it. So you cannot blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for things like that. You blame, you know, if somebody commits a sin, he cannot say that Allah made me this, make this. Allah gave you the chance to do good and gave you the chance to do bad. Allah gave, make it open for you and you chose to do the bad. When somebody commits the adultery or drink alcohol, he's the one who drink. He cannot blame the bad deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has given you this. But Allah also, by His mashia, allowed this to happen. إِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنْكُمْ وَلَا يَرْضَى لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفْرُ وَإِن تَشْكُرُوا يَرْضَهُ لَكُمْ. Now, Allah says in this verse, if you become disbelievers, Allah doesn't like it. Allah is ghani and doesn't like it. You become disbeliever. And if you become a believer, Allah will like it. In tashkur means you do the good deeds and so forth and believe. I go back to the irada kawniya, irada or mashi'a kawniya and mashi'a shar'iyya. Okay? These terms, you hear them from the scholars. Because nothing happens in this universe, mashi'a kawniya, it happens in this universe without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they happen to things that he likes and he doesn't like. يعني, just like people who are religious do not believe. Allah allowed them to do not believe. They are committing the kufr. And Allah does not like it, but it could happen. And if Allah, you know, the irada kawniya, if something Allah made that irada, it will happen. Like allowing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has, when we look at our life, the wars happen, or earthquake happens. We look at it's bad, but Allah allowed it to happen. Allah allowed it to happen. By His irada, universal irada or will, allowed it to happen. Now, irada shar'iyya, it means the will of Allah to follow sharia, in a way. Allah will tell you not to steal, not to commit sins, to do your prayers. Allah loves you to do it, and He will reward you if you do it. But if somebody chose not to do it, he has the choice. But in the hereafter, he will be asked for it. So this is the difference between things like that. Now, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلُ. Now, what the Shaykh is trying to say, that Allah has mashi'a, has will. In the second verse he used, أُحِلَّتْ لَكُمْ بَهِيمَةُ الْأَنْعَامِ إِلَّا مَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ غَيْرَ مُحِلِّ الصَّيْدِ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ مَا يُرِيمُ. Allah make His own rule, means make His own judgment. Irada hina, mean He will, His will is confirmed. The same thing. It's just like you have the intention and you have the mashi'a, you have the ability to do something. The same thing, and without comparison to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah has allowed things and He has the will. If Allah wills, He will allow them to fight each other. That's what the meaning of the verse. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا اقْتَتَلُوا. If Allah I don't know how to translate this, but وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا اقْتَتَلُوا. If Allah did not will them, allow them to fight, He would have stopped it or not allowed it, but it happened. The same thing, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ مَا يُرِيدُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that rule and people choose, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He makes hukum, that means it's actually a universal will, it will happen. Just like when we now look at back, Allah allowed, or by His will, made Abu Jahl kafir. It happened. Abu Lahab, the same thing, prescribed. Remember the rule or the fundamentals of Qadr. We said al-mashi'a, al-ilm, al-kitaba means this being prescribed in the lawh al-mahfuz. يعني when you believe in al-qadr, whatever you do, you have the choice in this dunya, but in the end, whatever you do is already written. Even if you make dua, Allah change that, what happens in that year for you, will give you rizq or things, it's also written. You are not, it's just like a circle. And the circle that you can move, but you're still under the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That will happen to you. Okay? But inside it, you have the choice. Okay. So, the other verses now, we have one, the last one. وقوله تعالى فمن يرد الله فمن يرد الله أن يهديه يشرح صدره للإسلام ومن يرد أن يضله يجعل صدره ضيقا حرجا كأنما يصعد في السماء. Now فمن يرد, if Allah wills, He will guide these people. That's what the verse means, and make his chest open to accept hidayah. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want him to give him hidayah or become or guided, Allah will make his chest not accepting Islam. If you ask somebody to come to the prayer over me, usually if he's, yeah, let's go pray. That means it's a good sign that guys, this person is seeking knowledge, is seeking to be a good slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if he rejects, that means he's the one who's saying no, not Allah. And some people are يعني, foolish to the point that they claim that Allah did not give me hidayah. But you have to strive for it. Ya ibadi fastahduni ahdikum. You ask for the hidayah, hidayah will come. But if you sit at home watching movies and watching football games, hidayah will not come. Hidayah for the one who are seeking for knowledge, seeking for to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will guide them. That's why actually hidayah is irada kawniya. It's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says to the Prophet sallam, innaka la tahdi man ahbabt, walakin Allah yahdi man yasha. Allah says to the Prophet sallam, you cannot guide anyone. Allah has the hidayah. It's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not in our hands. Allah is the one who gives hidayah. But we have to work for it. If you've seen some kuffar, they always think about God. Till one sometime they read about Islam, they understand the concept, they might become believers. They come to the door to the masjid by themselves. And that's another subject that we are not doing good for our deen. We are not doing da'wah for our deen. Especially we are living and the kuffar around us everywhere. We are sometimes shy of talking about Islam, which is not fair. Okay. Now, the next 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 verses, they are in one subject. Okay? So, all of them, I will recite them very quickly, so that because they are in one subject, and approve a tribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Okay, what's the attribute here? Do good, and Allah loves who do good or nice, whatever. What kind of attributes? Allah loves, that's what the attribute here, okay. وَأَقْسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسَطِينَ. Be just, and Allah loves the one who being just. فما استقاموا لكم فاستقيموا لهم إن الله يحب المتقين. Allah loves the one who are pious or righteous. إن الله يحب التوابين ويحب المتطهرين. Allah loves the one who repent to him and who are purifying themselves. فسوف يأتي الله بقوم يحبهم ويحبونه. Allah will bring people or that Allah loves and they love him. يحبهم ويحبونه. He loves them and they love Allah سبحانه وتعالى. إن الله يحب الذين يقاتلون في سبيله صفا كأنهم بنيان مرصوص. Allah loves the one who go to jihad and they are in one line, structured in one line. And the last verse, Allah says, قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم. And if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow my steps, Allah will love you. Now, the whole, these six, seven verses talking about what? That Allah loves. This is the attribute we are trying to affirm. If somebody tells you that Allah does not love, what do you tell him? These verses in the Quran, how do you understand them? That's why some of the Asha'ira say, they do not accept that Allah loves. We cannot accept this. We either make their understanding is right, or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran is right. But we believe that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about himself, that he loves the people who are good or nice to others. Allah loves the muhsineen. Allah loves the just. Allah loves the righteous people. Allah loves the one who loves him. Okay? You cannot change that. And if somebody, if when you say Allah loves, just like we also love, we are not the same. The love of Allah is different than ours. The attribute of Allah is different than ours. But the meaning is understandable. That Allah loves. Allah loves, يعني, واتخذ الله إبراهيم خليلا. خليلا is the one who the most beloved. The closest. So Allah loves Ibrahim alayhi salam and he loves Muhammad. He took them as يعني, the most noble prophets and creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad and Ibrahim, they were chosen as akhillah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all even prophets. So these meanings tell us that Allah loves us. Loves the one who are doing the good things. But if Allah comes to one, somebody comes and tell you that Allah does not love, no, this is not the meaning of the verse, you do not accept it. Because we have to affirm what Allah affirms of himself. And we negate what Allah negates for himself. I don't want to go through the details of these verses, because if we're going to explain each verse in full, we're not going to finish. يعني, what means in Allah يحب التوابين. What التوابين? The one who repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do you repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You repent by stopping doing the bad, by starting doing the good, by regretting that what you did is bad, and you start doing the good thing. See, that's part of what some of the scholars say, conditions or provisions of having repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One important condition of repentance is what? You don't, you know, some people repent maybe in the last minute of their life. Or when the sun rises from the west. So there is a hadith says, Allah will not accept their repentance if the sun comes up from the west. So this is a condition. As long as you have your life, you can repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if somebody been doing bad, and he runs, oh, he's gonna die, and he start repenting. Khalas. It's very close to death. That's why, take your chances, always you have to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, many ahadith, إِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ فِي الْيَوْمِ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةً. I repent and make istighfar to Allah daily, more than 70 times a day. And this is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. We should do more. Should do more. to remit more. And this is Rasulullah who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him for his work. Anyway, so because the time is up, so this is the, maybe I will close in one thing, that many scholars say it, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ لَفَأَتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبُّكُمُ اللَّهِ. It's every, the nature, the instinct of human being is that they love their God, they love their Ilah, because what ibadah means is part of it is to worship. What meaning of the worship is that you have love, the things that you worship. It's a fundamental thing. Nobody worships something he doesn't like. It's by common sense. Okay? So, the issue here is that Allah loves you. How you make Allah loves you? Allah loves you if you follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's a simple. فَاتَّبِعُونِي يَحْبَبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. And we, if we argue with these people who are Matridi, Mu'tazili, Sufi, Shi'i, when they translate or interpret these verses wrong way, we tell them, ya akhi, Allah says, فَاتَّبِعُونِي يَحْبَبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Follow Muhammad. We are telling you, follow the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Allah will love you. But if you don't, Allah will not love you. Simple as that. The Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Who does not like my sunnah, he's not one of my followers. And he's not from the followers of Muhammad ﷺ, that means he's a loser. So this is what I have today. Inshallah, we'll continue. It's going to take us another maybe 2-3 weeks because Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah ta'ala quoted maybe 100 verses from the Quran with attributes. That's why I collected these maybe 6-7 for mahabba or the love. And every time we will come to this, and sometimes some repetition happens, but when he repeats some of these attributes, we'll go faster, inshallah. Wa jazakumullah khair, wa barakallahu fikum. If you have any question or comment, we'll inshallah talk about it. Jazakumullah khair.